we're doing a short little series about the Advent prophecies of Jesus, and so it is more topical. I'll have them up there for us tonight, and we'll go through those scriptures as they arise. You still will want your Bible open because it's sometimes easier to read it from your own pages. Besides that, you can also see the context before and after than what I've just got up on the screen. But they will be up on the screen. But with all that said, let's pray. Father, thank you for tonight. Thank you for this opportunity we have to look at these scriptures that talk about the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. And Lord, as we'll mention in a moment, it's so glorious to think that Jesus has come once, but even better the fact that he's coming again. And so, Lord, we can't wait for that day. Help us look forward to that with anticipation. Fill us with your Spirit tonight as we would look at these scriptures in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, Advent is over, right? No, wrong. Technically, it's correct. The season of Advent, churches that follow the liturgical calendar, you know, they celebrate Advent from the final Sunday in November until Christmas Eve. Once Christmas comes, most Christians put away the idea of Advent. You know, we've taken all the candy out of our Advent calendars, and that's all done and over with. We're celebrating the fact that he has come, so we're not just anticipating his coming anymore. And that is worth celebrating, that he has come. That's the big deal about Christmas, his incarnation. But there is more to Advent than Christmas, because there is more than one coming of Christ. And the Bible is clear that Jesus has come once, and that right now today he's physically at the right hand of God, having ascended there prior to the day of Pentecost, but he will come again. So his first arrival was one of humility. His second one will be one of glory, will be one of power. The first time Jesus came to serve, the second time he comes back to rule, to reign as king. And so when we think of Advent, well, for 2016, Christmas has passed, but the anticipation of his Advent lives on, because that's what we're looking forward to. We've already seen his first coming, so now we're looking forward to the second. Now, as I was talking about earlier, to tackle all the prophecies about Jesus' second coming is impossible to do it tonight. Whole volumes of books have been written about just singular topics of some of the things we'll be looking at tonight. Just some of the things accompanying that his return. So tonight we're just going to get an overview. We're going to get a flyby of some of these things, and even then we had to pick and choose. And so if I left out your favorite scripture, I'm sorry. That's just the way time allows us tonight. But what are some of the things that we can expect as the time draws near? Well, that's what we're going to look at tonight, basically in three areas. Number one, what to expect among Israel. Number two, what to expect among the world. And three, what we can expect within the church. Now, before we get there, I think it's important that we establish a couple of foundational principles without which I don't think we can get too terribly far. Number one, and probably most importantly, is that we need to remember these are non-essential doctrines. They're important doctrines. They're glorious doctrines, but they are non-essential. They don't forbid someone from getting saved or not. There's certain things about Jesus' second coming that are essential, primarily the fact that he is coming again. A person cannot call himself or herself an Orthodox Christian without believing that Jesus is returning in the future. That is essential to our faith. But obviously, there is not everything that we totally understand about it. There's going to be mysteries. There's going to be unknowns that will remain unknown and will remain mysteries until we actually see them come out and play out in real time. In addition, it is doubtful that too many of us, if any of us, were very familiar with any of the prophecies regarding Jesus' return the night that we were first saved. You know, that's not generally included with the gospel message. But that said, as Christians grow and we learn more of the Bible, then this is a topic that born-again Christians ought to receive, because this is the work that the Holy Spirit is going to confirm in us. Yes, this is truth that Jesus is coming back, okay? And so we agree on the general while perhaps disagreeing on the specifics, and that's okay. Now, as most of you know, and we need to reaffirm, Calvary Chapel Tyler does strongly affirm, and we do teach a pre-tribulational, pre-millennial view of the rapture and the second coming, but not all born-again, Bible-believing Christians hold to that. There's going to be amillennialists in heaven. There's going to be people we're worshiping the Lord Jesus with side by side throughout eternity that passionately disagree on some of these issues. And that's not just okay. That's wonderful. That's a great thing. So that's the first thing. The second thing we need to do And we'll get to this a little bit later on tonight as well. We do need to make a distinction between the rapture and the second coming. Now, again, this is something that's debated, but this is the perspective that we hold at Calvary Chapel Tyler, and multitudes of other churches do as well. To be real clear from the upfront, every Orthodox Christian believes in a rapture. Now, what's debated is the timing. To ignore the teaching that, you know, the dead in Christ will rise and the living saints will join the Lord Jesus, well, that's to ignore big portions of Scripture, and even the most steadfast amillennialists will hold to those. They just interpret them differently than what we do, right? Now, we see these things as kind of part of the same overall prophetic event, but they're separated by the several years, 7 years of the tribulation, because Christians are not appointed to wrath. 1 Thessalonians 5:9 tells us this, will not be on earth when God's wrath is poured out upon it. And it clearly is. And even the world recognizes that during the tribulation time, that is the day of the wrath of the Lamb. We'll see that later on in Revelation chapter 6, verse 17. And so there will be people who get saved after the rapture takes place. We'll talk about that a little bit later. But we who currently believe in Jesus Christ will be with Christ during that time. And so that means as born-again Christians, we're waiting Jesus' glorious calling for us to go home before we're looking for his glorious return when he steps foot upon the earth. Now, with that all in mind, we should certainly know what the Bible says both about the rapture of the church and the second coming of Christ. Why is that? Because it's all part of the glorious plan of God. Just because we won't personally experience the days of the Great Tribulation doesn't mean we shouldn't know about them. We should. Why? Number one, it's a doctrine from God, and that makes it inherently valuable. Number two, it's motivation for us to share the gospel, in that the more we understand the days of the Great Tribulation, the less we'll want anybody to endure those days. And then third, it's hope for our future, because we can see the plans of God at work unfolding with our own eyes. And so as the days are drawing near and things out there are looking worse and worse and worse, we can know our God's still on the throne. We can know that all things are still working for his glory and his will. And the more we understand that, the better we praise our God. So as I mentioned, we're going to look at what to expect with Israel, what to expect among the world, what to expect among the church. First is Israel. Now, this throws a lot of people, because generally the first thing people do when looking at prophecies is we look for ourselves. We want to say what God has to say about us in the Scripture, so we tend to look for statements about the United States of America. Well, guess what? There's nothing there. Now, that's not unusual. The Scripture doesn't have anything to say about Ecuador. It doesn't have anything to say about South Africa either. That's not where the focus of the Bible is. The geographic focus of the Bible is and has always been the nation of Israel. That's where God chose to send his Messiah. That's where God chose to entrust his message. We know the Lord Jesus is our Lord because he was first sent to Israel, and it's from Israel that the salvation of God has gone out into the entire world. So it makes sense that when we look at prophecies concerning Jesus' second coming, we begin with Israel. And the first thing we see is that Israel will be attacked, but Israel will be protected. Now, Israel's always been hated by the world, and that continues to this very day. We've seen that playing out in the last week in our own national politics, right? A few days ago, the United Nations passed its latest resolution against Israel, with the United States very publicly abstaining from the vote, thus intentionally allowing its passage. And just today, if you were following the news at all, Secretary of State John Kerry defended the move. He accused Israel of breaking international law by allowing construction of the West Bank and East Jerusalem. If you're not aware, the Obama administration back in 2011, as far back as that, has called publicly for Israel to return to the 1967 borders, which means Israel has to defend its sovereignty from the narrowest point of a 9-mile strip of land that reaches from the West Bank to the Mediterranean Sea, just indefensible border. Now, obviously, presidential administrations change, but worldwide opposition to Israel does not. The Bible tells us of at least two major battles or wars involving Israel prior to the final return of Christ. One is a little bit more debated than others, but one is Psalm 83. Psalm 83 is a psalm of Asaph, and that describes a confederation of nations against Israel. And this confederation is, interestingly, one that's not accounted for in the books of Samuel, of Kings, or of Chronicles. The psalmist cries out to God for help against Israel's enemies and then lists them out, and I've got it up here, but you can see it in your Bible. Psalm 83, verses 3 through 8. They have taken crafty counsel against your people and consulted together against your sheltered ones. They have said, come and let us cut them off from being a nation that the name of Israel may be remembered no more. For they have consulted together with one consent. They form a confederacy against you, the tents of Edom and the Ishmaelites, Moab and the Hagrites, Gebal, Ammon and Amalek, Philistia with its inhabitants of Tyre. Assyria has also joined with them. They've helped the children of Lot, Selah. So what makes this so interesting is that this list of enemies is so clear. You've got Egypt and Moab, both which comprise modern-day Jordan. You've got Ammon, which could be part of Jordan, somewhat part of Syria. The Ishmaelites and Hagrites, which are most likely references to Arabs. Gebal and Tyre are areas in modern-day Lebanon. Amalek is West Sinai. Philistia, of course, are the Palestinians, basically referring to all of Israel's immediate neighbors that were enemies then and are still enemies today. And the Bible shows that each of these people had opposed Israel at given points and times, but never has a historical account of a singular confederation of them against Israel. But that's exactly what's spoken of here. So we can't say with 100% certainty that the scripture is still unfulfilled, but that seems to be the case. And if they do come against Israel at once, it is certain that God will protect his people, as you can see later on in 83 verse 17, the psalmist prays that God would allow his enemies to be put to shame. Sets the stage, though, for Israel to further strengthen its borders and to dwell in safety, because once that immediate confederation of their immediate neighbors is shut down, well, things are going to change at that point. That sets the stage for what is most certainly a future battle yet to be faced, described in Ezekiel 38 and 39. We looked at it not too many weeks ago, the battle of Gog and Magog. And there God describes another confederation formed against Israel that's led by a prince by the name of Gog. And this confederation is comprised of dozens of areas, basically. But the modern areas of Russia, Turkey, several of the Stan nations around the Black Sea, Iran, many of the Islamic nations in northern and eastern Africa, Saudi Arabia, and more, just a whole bunch of nations. These nations all descend upon Israel. And Israel at this point, as you can see in Ezekiel chapter 38, verses 8 and verse 11, these nations, or Israel rather, is described as a nation that dwells safely. And that's a key phrase there. He dwells safely. That's certainly not the case today. But after the battle that we just described in Psalm 83, who knows what kind of safety measures will be in place after that kind of previous military victory. In any case, at that point, they dwell safely. These nations pounce on Israel, but they're soundly defeated by the Lord God and a grand witness to himself. We read in Ezekiel 39, verses 3 through 7, "Then I will knock the bow out of your left hand and cause the arrows to fall out of your right hand. You shall fall upon the mountains of Israel, you and all your troops and the peoples who are with you. I will give you to birds of prey of every sort, and to the beasts of the field to be devoured. You shall fall on the open field, for I have spoken, says the Lord God. And I will send fire on Magog and on those who dwell in security in the coastlands. Then they shall know that I am the Lord. So I will make my holy name known in the midst of my people Israel, and will not let them profane my holy name anymore. Then the nations shall know that I am the Lord, the Holy One in Israel." God draws out these nations and God slaps them down. God defeats them soundly. And in that day, there will be no doubt that the God of the universe has stood up on Israel's behalf. All the other nations of the world will have abandoned her or actively acted against her, but God has remained faithful. And he shows here that he will protect his people. And not only will the world recognize the work of God, but so will Israel herself. And in turn, this may be the primary event, or at least one of the crucial events, for the next major thing that happens with Israel, and that's when they finally come to faith in Christ. Never forget that the Jesus we worship as God and Christ is the Hebrew Jewish Messiah. Jesus is the fulfillment of the covenant promises that God made with Israel, and one day they will see him as their own Messiah. And although it may seem incredulous to us that Jews will openly, actively, intentionally worship Jesus, that's exactly what the Bible promises will happen prior to Jesus' return. And Paul wrote about this to the Romans in regards to Gentile Christians not becoming too arrogant in our own faith in Christ, that own grace that we have received. And he wrote in Romans 11, 25 through 29, "For I do not desire, brethren, that you should be ignorant of this mystery, lest you should be wise in your own opinion, that blindness in part has happened to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles has come in, And here it is. And so all Israel will be saved. As it is written, the deliverer will come out of Zion. He will turn away ungodliness from Jacob. For this is my covenant with them when I take away their sins. Concerning the gospel, they are enemies for your sake. But concerning the election, they are beloved for the sake of the fathers. For the gifts and the calling of God are irrevocable. God made promises to Israel, and he's not going to take back a single one. The gifts he gave, the calling he gave, is going to be fulfilled. He made promises. He's going to keep those promises. He promised him a deliverer. He's going to give him the deliverer. He promised the king. The king will come. He promised him salvation through Messiah. That will happen. They'll finally see the one true Messiah as their Lord. When will it take place? Well, in the timing of God, when the time and the fullness of the Gentiles has come in, probably when every Gentile that needs to be saved is going to be saved. But in God's timing, which cannot be fully known, will it take place? Without a doubt. Now, isn't it a wonderful thing that God keeps his word? This is one reason I believe it's so foolish and short-sighted for Christians to spiritualize all of God's promises to Israel away. It doesn't really belong to Israel, it belongs to the church. And we find some way of tying in. I think that's a foolish thing to do, because if God didn't mean what he specifically said to Israel, then how do we know what he means, that he means what he specifically says to us? What God promises, God performs, period. Our God is faithful. Israel's going to come to faith. Now, of course, just because Israel comes to faith in Christ doesn't mean that these newly believing Jews will have an easy time in the world until Jesus comes back. And it seems that much of this, if not all of it, will take place during the years of the Great Tribulation that Jesus described as the Great Tribulation. And during this time, Israel will be roundly persecuted. And Jesus himself said this, Matthew 24:9-14, then they will deliver you up to the tribulation and kill you. You'll be hated by all nations for my name's sake. Then many will be offended and will betray one another and will hate one another. Then many false prophets will rise up and deceive many. And because lawlessness will abound, the love of many will grow cold. But he who endures to the end shall be saved. And this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in all the world as a witness to all the nations, and then the end will come. When Jesus spoke this, of course, he was speaking to his disciples. But remember who his disciples were. They were all Jews. And Jesus prophesied of a day in which the Jews who believed in him would experience a time of such great trouble as that gospel is being preached around the world. You know, John wrote in the book of Revelation how Satan would pursue Israel like a dragon pursues a woman into the wilderness, trying to kill her as well as any other children she might have had. Revelation chapter 12 talks about that. It's a very picturesque way of describing the persecution that believing Jews will suffer by satanic forces during the days of the Great Tribulation. At that time, many people will come to faith through Israel's witness, but there will be, without question, a lot of suffering along the way. The good news, though, even though that sounds bad, the good news is that suffering doesn't last long. 7 years of tribulation is terrible, but at least there's an end to it. Jesus comes back in that glorious second advent to rescue his people. He's their rescuer. He puts an end to the forces of Satan forever. Okay, so that's some things that we need to expect among Israel before Jesus' second coming. Well, what do we expect around the world? The primary geographic focus of the Bible may be Israel, but Israel's not the only nation mentioned. Nations all over the current Middle East are mentioned by name, by the way, not just in reference to immediate fulfillment of prophecies that were fulfilled during the days of Isaiah and Jeremiah and others, but also in future prophecies yet to be fulfilled. But beyond that, the Bible has a lot to say about the state of the world outside of Israel as those days draw nearer for Jesus' return. For one, we know that there's going to be cosmic signs and wonders which will be recognized by the world but generally ignored. Jesus specified some of these things to be expected around the world earlier on in the same Olivet Discourse. Matthew 24, you can just look up if you wanted in your Bibles, Matthew 24, verses 4 through 8. Jesus answered and said to them, "Take heed that no one deceives you, for many will come in my name, saying, 'I am the Christ,' and will deceive many. And you will hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you're not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For a nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. There will be famines, pestilences, and earthquakes in various places. All these are the beginnings of sorrows." Some of this may be familiar passages to some of us. And some of these prophecies are oftentimes used as benchmarks for some of the things that we see around the world today. And no doubt we're seeing previews of some of these things that Jesus spoke of. But overall, it may be better to view these in light of the original seals that are opened by Jesus during the beginning days of the Great Tribulation. In Revelation chapter 6, John describes Jesus opening these seals, and they see what the famous four horsemen of the apocalypse. And if you remember, and you could even turn to Revelation 6 if you want to see, but we see seeming imitation of Christ, a man on a white horse. He has the power to conquer the world. Per verse 5 up here, many will come in my name saying, I am the Christ. We see, second, a rider on a red horse with the power to make war, just like it says on verse 6, there'll be wars and rumors of war. We see a rider on a black horse that proclaims economic hardships and famine, also per verse 6. We see a rider on a pale horse bringing death, which we see here in verse 7, pestilences and all sorts of things there. The Bible is absolutely consistent on what it describes there as the end gets closer. All over the world, people experience various troubles. All these troubles, by the way, are designed to get their attention, which it does. What it does not do is bring everyone to repentance. Well, they see the work of God, but they harden their hearts. And Revelation chapter 6 goes on to describe what some of this looks like. Revelation 6, verse 12 through 16. And I looked when he opened the sixth seal, and behold, there was a great earthquake, and the sun became like black as sackcloth of hair. And the moon became like blood. And the stars of heaven fell to the earth as a fig tree drops its late figs when it's shaken by a mighty wind. Then the sky receded as a scroll when it's rolled up, and every mountain and island was moved out of its place. Imagine that would get some attention. And it did. And the kings of the earth, the great men, the rich men, the commanders, the mighty men, every slave and every free man, hid themselves in the caves and in the rocks of the mountains and said to the mountains and the rocks, fall on us and hide us from the face of him who sits on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. Even in the midst of these horrendous earthquakes and solar turmoil and meteor showers that are falling upon the earth, people harden their hearts against God. They'll know it's God at work. They'll even recognize it as the time of God's wrath, but instead of repenting, they hide. Later judgments are described in Revelation, specifically said where people refuse to repent and give God the glory. Revelation 16, verses 9, verse 11 talks about that. How can people see these incredible events and not repent? Well, because mankind's sinful. Because mankind is stubborn. Understand that when God sends his judgments upon the world, he does so out of his mercy just as much as his righteousness. And you say, well, how can we say that? Well, because God didn't have to do it that way. God didn't have to send his judgments gradually. You know, if God chose, he could simply blink the whole world's population into hell directly. And it would be absolutely righteous for him to do so, because all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. But instead, he gives opportunity after opportunity after opportunity for people to repent. God wants people to be saved, but God won't force anyone to be saved. If someone chooses to reject God, God will allow them to make that choice. Obviously, that's not something we want to do. Whenever you know the Lord's calling, you want to respond. By the way, that applies just as much to Christians as non-Christians. For the non-Christian, the right response is repentance and faith in Jesus Christ. But for Christians, the response is confession and repentance from whatever current sin we might be facing. God will allow us to face the consequences of our sin if we choose to persist in them. But what he desires from us, what sometimes he brings some consequences around to bring us to, is a place of humility and confession and faith. Well, in addition to the world's general refusal to repent towards God, there will also be a deep hatred of Israel and worship of Antichrist. Now, we've already mentioned this tremendous persecution that believing Israel will face prior to Jesus' return. We also know from the Bible is that Satan is going to give his power to a man named in Revelation as the beast. We know him elsewhere as Antichrist, which is a false and evil imitation of the true Lord Jesus. And this man will apparently have a fatal wound, be miraculously healed, and thus worshipped by the world as a false god. Satan sends another evil messenger that's known as the false prophet to proclaim this beast and cause people around the world to worship his image. Revelation picks up this idea, Revelation chapter 13, verses 14 through 15, talking of the false prophet. And he deceives those who dwell on the earth by those signs which he was granted to do in the sight of the beast, or an antichrist, telling those who dwell on the earth to make an image to the beast who was wounded by the sword and lived. And he was granted to give breath to the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and cause as many as who would not worship the image of the beast to be killed. So you've got a statue that apparently lives by the word of this false prophet, and the statue is of the beast, and people are supposed to bow down and worship it. And this is when the infamous number 666 is given, described as the number of a mark which must be worn by all people on the earth in order to buy or sell anything. Those who take the mark show that they worship the beast. Those who don't are hunted down and killed. Well, where is this image of the beast erected? Well, apparently it's in a rebuilt Jerusalem temple, committing what Jesus called the abomination of desolation, which itself is a reference to an earlier prophecy from Daniel, Daniel chapter 11, verse 31. Now, in that version of the prophecy, Daniel prophesied of a man who would, he referred to a Seleucid king, which is a Syrian, a Greek king, by the name of Antiochus Epiphanes. And this man desecrated the Jerusalem temple in 168 BC when he basically slaughtered a pig on the altar in Jerusalem. That was a sign that set up this future abomination to come. And so when Jesus said there will be the abomination that makes desolation, he was referring back to that event as a type, what's going to take place in the future. This future event would be performed by Antichrist and his false prophet. Paul wrote to the Thessalonians about this very event, and he says it was an essential event that must take place prior to Jesus' second coming. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, 3 through 4, let no one deceive you by any means, for that day, Jesus' second coming, will not come unless the falling away comes first, and the man of sin is revealed, the son of perdition, who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he sits as God in the temple of God, showing that himself that he is God. The same event that we just read about in Revelation. To the Thessalonians, Paul is reassuring them that they hadn't missed Jesus' return. There were other events that needed to take place first. The sign, the abomination of desolation, being the most important sign to take place prior to Jesus' second coming. Which brings up an interesting question for us. If there is a sign that absolutely must take place prior to Jesus' return, what does this do to the doctrine of imminency? Imminency says that Jesus can come back at any moment. What this does to it is absolutely nothing. Because as we'll see in a moment, the Bible does teach imminency, but it teaches imminency in regards to the rapture, not the second coming. But that said, even if someone doubts the teaching of a pre-tribulational rapture, the doctrine of imminency holds. How so? Because of the reality of death. Any one of us has the potential for seeing Jesus at any time. The only thing that separates from you and eternity is one single heartbeat. Are you ready to see your Maker and your Judge? Because he could call you at any moment. For then as many of people around the world will completely reject God, they will worship Antichrist, they will hate Israel, there will be others. And of those others, there will be many who repent and get saved. Sometimes the question is asked if it's possible for anybody to come to faith in Christ after the days of the Great Tribulation begins. And the answer is not only is it possible, it is absolutely certain. John specifically tells us of this in Revelation chapter 7, verses 13 through 15. And one of the elders answered, saying to me, "Who are these arrayed in white robes, and where did they come from?" I said to him, "Sir, you know." And he said to me, "These are ones who come out of the great tribulation, who washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore, they are before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will dwell among them." Now, contextually, this comes just after an event where John sees 144,000 that are counted out from the tribes of Israel, sealed with God's protection for the days of the great tribulation. John goes on from there to see this great multitude now, totally different group. One is 144,000 of Israel, very specific tribes mentioned. Here it's this great multitude that can't be counted from every nation, tribe, and people, Revelation 7, 9. And they're clothed in white robes, singing praises to God. And so when John asks who the group is, he's given this answer. These are people who come out of the great tribulation. So they got saved when? During the great tribulation. They were martyred during the tribulation, but there's no question that they belong to God through the work of Jesus the Lamb. So for those of us who do believe in a pre-tribulational rapture of the church, who else could they be other than people who come to faith after the rapture? They've come to faith during the days of the great tribulation. They're gloriously saved. Again, it emphasizes the fact God wants people to be saved. God gives people every opportunity to be saved. All we need to do is take it. Eventually, time runs out for all of us. We don't want to waste the time we've been given. All right, so that's Israel and that's the world. We've looked at a lot at this point, what the Bible has to say about those days of the Great Tribulation before Jesus physically comes back, the days that immediately lead up to Jesus' return upon the earth. During that time, the Bible strongly indicates that the church, us, will not be on the earth, but will be with heaven. So what can we expect within the church? And again, this is something that's debated. It's important, but not essential. But in any case, as the church, we look to our primary event that precedes Jesus' second coming, and that's the rapture. Now, first of all, there is a rapture, and the timing is imminent. Although you won't find the word rapture in the Bible, but neither will you find the word Trinity. Just because the word's not there doesn't mean the doctrine's not there. The doctrine is there. Actually, what we describe often in terms of only talking about the rapture of believers is actually a large part of a larger event that happens simultaneously, and that's the resurrection of the saints. Now, one of the most famous scriptures we go to is found in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 15 through 18. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And thus we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. And this, which is Paul's earlier letter to the Thessalonians, he reassured the Christians there. Not only had they not missed Jesus' return, but their loved ones who had died had not missed the blessing of Christ either. There will be a day that Jesus comes back to earth, but he says, by no means will it precede the event in which Jesus calls all believers, living and dead, to himself. He describes here a time when the trumpet is going to be blown and those who've died in faith will be raised to be with Christ, followed just by a split second later by born-again Christians who are still alive on the earth at the time. Now, please note, and it's very important here, where we meet the Lord. It's in the air. The resurrection, the rapture, is not the second coming when Jesus sets his foot upon the earth. FYI, he sets his foot upon Mount Olivet, where he gave his discourse. You can read that prophecy, Zechariah chapter 14, verse 4. But at this time, we meet the Lord in the air. We return with him to glory, always being with him. Well, when will this event, the rapture, takes place? Well, nobody knows, but it will be soon. And the same letter, it goes on just in the next couple verses, actually, 1 Thessalonians 5, 1 and 2. But concerning the times and the seasons, brethren, you have no need that I should write to you, for you yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so comes as a thief in the night. And the whole idea is that it comes quickly. It comes unexpectedly. This is where the doctrine of imminence comes in. We know when Jesus will come and call us home. So what does that mean? It means we need to be ready at all times. Now consider for a moment what's involved with that. If Jesus were to call us tonight, the doctrine of imminence, he says that he could, would you be ready? For anyone who isn't a born-again believer, they're most certainly not ready. But what about us as Christians? Are we ready to see our Lord Jesus? Are there certain things that he's given us that we've left undone? We know we've left them undone. Is there some sort of unrepentant sin in our life that we haven't dealt with, we haven't confessed? How tragic it would be to be called to stand before Jesus in heaven and immediately have regrets. Now, thankfully, our salvation isn't dependent on that. It's not dependent on any obedient works, nor will we forever have regrets in heaven. Because what do we know from the promise of heaven? He's going to wipe every tear from our eye. But may we live in such a way where we have less reason for tears in the first place. Our Lord is coming, and he's coming quickly, so we want to be ready. Now, as the church, we may not be on earth for the second coming, but that doesn't mean we won't have anything to do with the second coming. We'll actually have front row seats. The church will be with Jesus at his second coming. John goes on to write in Revelation 19, verses 11 through 14, "Now I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse. He who sat on him was called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he judges and makes war. His eyes were like a flame of fire, and his head were many crowns. He had a name written that no one knew except himself. He was clothed with a robe dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. And the armies in heaven, clothed in fine linen, white and clean, followed him on white horses." Who are the ones in Jesus' army? It's us. The saints of God are consistently described throughout the book of Revelation and elsewhere as being clothed in fine linen. We have been clothed in the righteousness of Christ, and we will accompany our Lord Jesus on his glorious return to earth. Now, keep in mind, we may be described here as an army, but there's no need to fight. There won't be a need to fight. Although all the world's armies will have gathered together in the field known as Armageddon, poised to battle against the Lord Jesus, all Jesus needs to do is show up, and the rebellious world is defeated. There's a battlefield described, but there's no actual battle. The next words that go on just talk about the carnage that's left behind for the scavenger carrion birds. And that sounds gory, but it is glorious. Not that God takes joy in us. He doesn't. He expressly told Ezekiel he takes no pleasure in the death of the wicked. He would much rather the wicked person turn from his evil ways and live, Ezekiel 33:11. But how can the display of Jesus' infinite power be anything except glorious? Because that's our Lord. That's our God in action. He just needs to arrive, and evil is instantly defeated. Now, Christian, that's your God. And that sort of glorious display that's promised for the future ought to give us a lot of hope for today. Why is that? Because Jesus has no less power today than he will on the day of his return. He's the same God yesterday, today, and forever. So whatever problems you have, whatever pain you have, you take that to the victorious, conquering, powerful Lord Jesus. His strength is infinite, and he'll give us exactly what we need. Now, this is all at the end, right at Jesus' return. But is there anything that the Bible says to the church for today in regards for some of these things leading up to his return? Well, yes. Number one, we need to beware. The church is to expect apostasy. The church is to expect false teaching. 1 Timothy 4, chapter 1 through 3, Paul writes, "Now the Spirit expressly says that in the latter times some will depart from the faith, giving heed to deceiving spirits and doctrines of demons, speaking lies and hypocrisy, having their own conscience seared with a hot iron, forbidding to marry and commanding to abstain from foods which God created to be received with thanksgiving by those who believe and know the truth." Paul could not have been clearer here to his friend and his son in the faith. The latter times, the end days, will be days of apostasy. False doctrine will be spouted out by false teachers, and it will cause people to veer away from the truth. Some people, it says, will depart from the faith. They'll leave the gospel of grace to immerse themselves in legalism, which is demonic in origin. And when the scriptures are twisted to control and abuse the people of God, we can be sure that that is a demonic attack upon the people of God. So what do we do to guard ourselves? Well, we don't veer away from the scripture. We stick to the scripture. That's exactly what Paul went on to tell Timothy when he warned Timothy about this again in his second letter, because this was so important that he couldn't just tell Timothy about it once. He had to tell him about it twice. 2 Timothy 4, verses 1 through 4. "I charge you, therefore, before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who will judge the living and the dead as is appearing in his kingdom, preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season. Convince, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and teaching. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but according to their own desires, because they have itching ears, they will heap up for themselves teachers. They will turn their ears away from the truth and be turned aside to fables." Timothy was to preach the truth because the time was coming when evil people would teach lies and they would be believed. And more than that, those lies would be desired. Those false doctrines and fables were things that people heaped up for themselves instead of wanting the truth of God, which sometimes brings conviction and rebuke, which is godly and good. False Christians would desire false teaching that tickled their ears and made them feel good. And this kind of false teaching has always existed around the edges of the church, at times been proclaimed through the midst of it. But there's a clear association here with the end times, with the latter days. The closer the time comes for Jesus' return, the closer the time comes for Jesus' call to the church to be raptured, the more these false teachings will come to prominence. Just turn on the TV. It's difficult to see how we could be any closer to the end. Whole TV networks are funded through the lies of false teachers who have been welcomed by some well-meaning people and maybe supposed Christians around the world. Some truly are believers, I'm sure, who've been duped, but others are false converts who've been defrauded and deluded by their own desire to have their ego stroked by a guy in a fancy suit on TV. And we want to beware. What's commonly known in the world as Christendom is filled with false teaching. Just because something has a cross slapped on it, just because something, you know, somebody put a Bible reference to it, doesn't make it biblical. Doesn't make it honoring to the Lord Jesus. We need to have discernment in these last days. And the only way for us to do that is to immerse ourselves in the truth. Timothy was to preach the word. We're to immerse ourselves in the word. We need to stay in the scriptures. Now, as we wait, what do we know? We need to be encouraged. We want to be assured our Jesus is coming. Sometimes when Christians talk with skeptics, they scoff at the idea of Jesus' return because, after all, it's been nearly 2,000 years. If Jesus was going to return, they say he would have done it by now. The Bible repeatedly speaks of Jesus' soon return, but what's soon? He hadn't done it yet. They say, well, there's the chink in the Bible's armor, right? Wrong. People were scoffing at the idea of Jesus' return back in Peter's day as well. Now, Peter knew better than anybody else that Jesus' promises are always true. He had heard Jesus predict his own rejection, crucifixion, resurrection multiple times. Peter never really did believe it until it came true. And so then when Jesus said he's going to return, Peter believed it. And he wrote about it, 2 Peter 3:8-9. But beloved, do not forget this one thing, that with the Lord one day is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is one day. The Lord is not slack concerning his promises, some count slackness, but is long-suffering towards us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. God isn't slack. He isn't lazy. He isn't incompetent. Perish the thought. No, he's patient, graciously, lovingly, giving time for the maximum number of people to repent and come to faith in Christ. God isn't on our time schedule. We're on his. And if 1,000 years is as a day to him, then it's only been a couple of days. It's not even been a whole weekend, right? God is going to fulfill his plan in his time. And when he does, it's going to be glorious. So we ought not to get discouraged in the waiting, but get busy, because every day that goes by is another day that God's given somebody an opportunity to be saved. It's been said that every day 150,000 people die. How many of those know the gospel? We've got the opportunity with the time we've been given to share the gospel with them, so we need to get about doing it. By the way, in the end, we don't have to rely on, as valuable as it is, we don't have to rely on Peter's word or Paul's word or any of the apostles' word regarding Jesus' return. We don't have to trust in that Jesus told me that he'd be returning. No, Jesus himself said it. We have the personal promise of Jesus himself, and Jesus said it directly to John, Revelation 22:12-13. And behold, I am coming quickly, and my reward is with me to give everyone according to his work. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. These are some of the very last words that Jesus spoke to John before the end of the book of Revelation. It left a lasting impression upon him. He who testifies to these things says, surely I am coming quickly. Maranatha, come, Lord Jesus. Jesus is coming. We have his word on it. What does the Bible have to say about Jesus' second advent? A lot. To Israel, there is a promise of his protection. There is a promise of their spiritual faith and salvation. To the world, there is assurance of judgment, but also an opportunity to repent and be saved. To the church, there is this warning against false teaching, but a glorious hope of his imminent call. Jesus is coming, and we want to be ready. You know, on that thought, when guests come to our homes, we all do at least a little bit of preparation. We'll put away things that we've left out on the table. We'll clean the bathrooms a little bit more, just because we want to be ready for the guest. How much we do likely changes with the identity of the guest. It's one thing for your best friend to drop by. It's another thing for your in-laws to come by. Be something else if you get a visit from a celebrity or a dignitary. Now multiply that to the nth degree when you consider the fact that you'll be seeing the Lord Jesus Christ. And he won't be dropping by your house, so to speak, though he's always with you wherever you are. But he'll be calling you home to the house that he has prepared for you. Now, first of all, that ought to be incredibly exciting, because we're going to go home to see our Lord Jesus. That we can be sure. Every promise he made is true. We'll be in his presence for all eternity. That's going to be awesome. Amazing grace. But second, it should ought to be a little bit sobering, because we want to ask ourselves, we need to ask ourselves, if we're prepared to see him, what would we say? Or what would he say to us if he called us home tonight? Guys, may we live every day as if it is the day we will see our Jesus. Amen? Amen. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for tonight. Thank you for your scriptures. And Lord, we just could scratch the surface tonight. And I pray that you would help the reality of Jesus's second advent be before our eyes every single day. Lord, not only that we would be looking forward to Jesus's rapture and his call for us to go home, but Lord, that we would take seriously the fact that we are in these end days. And Lord, you've got them planned out. Right now is the opportunity for people to get saved. So Lord, help us go out with this message. Help us go out with the truth of Jesus's promise so that others would look forward to this day with glorious anticipation as well and know what's coming. Lord, we thank you. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.